Brothers and sisters, let us enter into his gates of thanksgiving. Let us sing a song of praise to the Lord. For this is indeed the day the Lord has made. Let us be glad and rejoice in it. Amen.
All right. encouraged as we call upon the Holy Spirit to ordain our brother AKolla to the priesthood. I'm grateful for those who travel on 4 buses to come all this way to Pittsburgh. Thank you for coming. Also grateful for those who just came a short while. All are welcome. Special gratitude and welcome to Cardinal Sean O'Malley, our brother, who came from Boston to be with us today. And also my classmate, brother Bishop Donald Lippert, who came all the way from Mendi, Papua New Guinea. So we're not used to Bishop Don getting a bigger clap than Cardinal Sean. Welcome, everyone. Thank you for being here.
Brothers and sisters, let us acknowledge all the sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries. I confess to Almighty God and to you, my brothers and sisters, Grant the persevering obedience to your will to this deacon of your church, whom you graciously choose today for the office of the priesthood, so that by his ministry and life he may gain glory for you in Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Thank you.
A reading from the letter to the Ephesians. I then, a prisoner for the Lord, urge you to live in a manner worthy of the call you have received, with all humility and gentleness, with patience, bearing with one another through love, striving to preserve the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace. One body and one Spirit, as you were also called to the one hope of your call, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all. But grace was given to each of us according to the measure of Christ's gift. And he gave some as apostles, others as prophets, others as evangelists, others as pastors and teachers, to equip the holy ones for the work of ministry, for building up the body of Christ, until we all attain to the unity of faith and knowledge of the Son of God, to mature manhood, to the extent of the full stature of Christ. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Brothers and sisters in Christ, the word of God is alive and active. Let us stand up and welcome it. My ula, 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 la, 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 la.
Thank you. be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Luke.
Glory to you, O Lord.
When the hour came, he took his place at table with the apostles. He said to them, I have eagerly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I tell you, I shall not eat it again until there is fulfillment in the kingdom of God. Then he took a cup, gave thanks, and said, take this and share it among yourselves. For I tell you that from this time on, I shall not drink of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes. Then he took the bread, said the blessing, broke it, and gave it to them, saying, this is my body, which will be given for you. Do this in memory of me. And likewise the cup, after they had eaten, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood, which will be shed for you. Then an argument broke out among them about which of them should be regarded as the greatest. He said to them, the kings of the Gentiles lord it over them, and those in authority over them are addressed as benefactors. But among you it shall not be so. Rather, let the greatest among you be as the youngest, and the leader as the servant. For who is greater, the one seated at table, or the one who serves? Is it not the one seated at table? I am among you as the one who serves. It is you who have stood by me in my trials, and I confer a kingdom on you, just as my Father has conferred on me, that you may eat and drink at my table in my kingdom. And you will sit on thrones, judging the 12 tribes of Israel. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
The church in Africa today is probably the most vibrant faith community in our Catholic Church. Catholic population there has almost tripled since 1980. You certainly experienced this in Boston with a very large and active community of Ethiopians, Cape Verdeans, Nigerians, Ugandans, Kenyans, Congolese, and many other Africans who have found their way to our shores and have become a very vital part of our local church. In our province of St. Augustine, we're blessed with the presence of African friars who enrich our Capuchin life with their faith, culture, and energy. It's such a joy to celebrate AKolla's ordination that marks a milestone in the evolution of the St. Augustine province as we grow in our Catholicity and our call to be universal brothers in a fraternity that erases all boundaries of race, ethnicity, and language so that we will be able to witness to the solidarity and unity that Jesus identifies as the hallmark of discipleship. To AKolla's family and friends, we say thank you for forming AKolla in the life of faith and sharing him with us. We know that AKolla's mom is watching from her place in heaven. But today we welcome in a very special way all of Brother AKolla's relatives who are here. We welcome you with great affection and hope that you will feel part of our Capuchin family. AKolla, you're being ordained a priest the same week that Pope Francis recognized the heroic virtue of Father Augustine Tolton, the former slave and first Afro-American priest ordained in the United States. The Holy Fathers declared him venerable and put him on the road to canonization. What a great role model. Today, my dear brother, you are being ordained a Catholic priest. Your vocation is to participate in the priesthood of Jesus, the Good Shepherd. You know, in all of my years as a priest and religious, reading papal homilies and declarations, I must confess that no phrase has been as quoted as the words of Pope Francis, where he tells his priests that a shepherd should have the smell of his sheep. And that perfume should be the favorite brand for Capuchin priests. That's the kind of shepherd that Christ is calling you to be. To be close to the flock. To know them and be known by them. Remember, there will be a sniff test. Jesus tells us that the good shepherd prepared to leave the 99 and go after the one lost sheep. Today, some people might say that that approach is foolhardy. It's better to cut your losses and let the lost sheep be a tax write-off or an insurance claim. But Jesus tells us the good shepherd has a very special love for that lost sheep and doesn't rest until he finds him. Ironically enough, in today's world, too often in the church, we end up staying with the one sheep that's still in the flock while we allow the 99 to drift off. But our task is to pursue that lost sheep and bring them home to Christ. The shepherd leads, and the church needs her priests to be leaders of God's people, boldly inviting them to a life of sacrifice and fidelity that is the costly grace of discipleship. Jesus, our good shepherd, at the beginning of his ministry, goes to the synagogue in Nazareth, where he preaches his very first sermon. He reads from the prophet Isaiah, the very reading that you, AKolla, have chosen for The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me and anointed me to preach the good news to the poor. He sent me to proclaim release to captives, recovery of sight to the blind, and to set at liberty those who are oppressed. These words of Jesus' first sermon are his inaugural address. They're followed up by the actions and the words throughout the gospel by which Jesus makes the Father's mercy present in the world. The Messiah's love for the poor, the little ones, the suffering, and the sinner are a clear sign of the Father's love for all of us. Our priests are also anointed in the Spirit to continue that messianic mission of Jesus and to continue to make the Father's merciful and loving face present in our world. In some circles, being a priest is a very prestigious profession. Being a Capuchin priest has never been about prestige. The Italians have a saying. They say the Benedictines take a peasant and turn him into a gentleman. But the Capuchins take a gentleman and turn him into a peasant. Yes, a Capuchin priest must be a peasant, a man of the people. And one of the things that has characterized our ministry is the availability to take on unpleasant and difficult and challenging tasks and missions. When I was in seminary, our provincial Father Victor Green wrote to Rome and said, give us a new bishop and mission and make it the most difficult one in the world. And they wrote back immediately, said, go to Mendi, Papua New Guinea. And that mission has been such a great blessing for our province. For 200 years, the Capuchin friars were the fire department for the city of Paris. Many a beard and cord was singed off, I'm sure. Richelieu used to call us les pompiers de Dieu, God's firemen. I like to think that if the Capuchins were still running the fire department in Paris, Notre Dame would never burn down. If you go to Venice, you will see the Capuchin church there, in Redentore, on the island of Giudecca, just across from St. Mark's Cathedral. Il Redentore is one of the most magnificent churches of our order. The beams in the ceiling of the refectory were taken from the ships returning from the Battle of Lepanto. The people of Venice built that church for the friars in gratitude to the many Capuchins who stayed in the city caring for the plague victims at a time when most of the clergy fled. It puts you in mind of chapter 10 in our Capuchin constitutions that state, as disciples of Christ and sons of St. Francis, we must recall that our apostolic life requires a spirit ready to embrace the cross and persecution to the point of martyrdom for the faith and for love of God and our neighbor. How is that for a job description? It means being God's fireman, able to run toward the burning building and not away from it. And that is our vocation as a Capuchin priest. As a Capuchin priest, my brother, your challenge is to be a father and a brother at the same time. A very essential foundation for all priestly ministry is a deep personal bond with Jesus Christ. All formation and preparation for priesthood is an introduction into this friendship. The priest must be a man who knows Jesus intimately, who has encountered him and has learned to love him. For this reason, the priest must be above all a man of prayer, a truly spiritual man. In his relationship with Christ, the priest needs to discover that his life is not geared toward self-realization or success. A priest's life is not about building up for himself an interesting or comfortable life or setting up a community of admirers or devotees. A priest's life is about working for another, working for Christ. In the Gospels, the disciples are learning how to be Christ's representatives, pastors who don't lord it over the people, but feed them, because these same pastors love Christ. If you love me, feed my sheep, Jesus says. In another place, Jesus calls his disciples to the temple as part of their seminary or vocation preparation. He wants to point out that widow who is putting her last penny in the collection. Jesus doesn't say anything to her. She's completely unaware of the fact that Jesus is watching her. But she embodies what Jesus says in the Sermon on the Mount: don't give alms to be praised by men. Here the left hand doesn't know what the right hand is doing. So why does our Lord take his disciples there to show them this widow? Because they must learn to see people like her. She was invisible to the rich people. The disciples, the pastors, the priests, must have an eye for the little people. So Jesus invites his seminarian apostles to learn to see from his angle. They must be amazed at this kind of greatness. They must see who is really great in the kingdom of God. Jesus shapes their gaze so that they can become shepherds after his own heart. Jesus is always bringing people from the periphery to center stage, the marginalized, the fringe, the people who are blind, the lame, the lost, the beggars, the tax collectors, the prostitutes, the lepers. They all become the protagonists in Jesus' gospel. And for you, AKolla, as a Capuchin priest, Christ's little ones must be your special charge and friend. We are called to teach as Jesus did, with love and with infinite patience and with a burning sense of mission. Throughout the gospel, we see Jesus teaching his disciples how to be shepherds. When the apostles say, "Oh, send the people away," Jesus says, "No, feed them." And when the apostles say, "Get those kids out of here," Jesus says, "No, bring them to me for a blessing." When they're fighting over the first places at table, he teaches them to fight over the towel. He washes their feet. And finally, he teaches the hardest lesson of all, laying down his life for his people, even those who could care less. The good shepherd, by Jesus' definition, is the one who lays down his life for his people. In all the chapels of Mother Teresa's sisters, there's always a sign on the wall next to the crucifix. It says, "I thirst." Those are the words of Jesus, the Good Shepherd, at the very moment when he is laying down his life for his flock. He's thirsting for the lost sheep. He's thirsting for those who have stormed off, drifted away, or merely dozed off. A priest must have that same thirst. What are the sentiments of Jesus' priestly heart? Mercy and thirst for souls. A priest must be like a dad who makes sacrifices for his children, for his people. Priestly holiness, indeed, all Christian holiness, doesn't consist in being superhuman or having outstanding talent. Holiness is simply a loving obedience that makes us available where God calls us to be. The obedience that does not rely on our human qualities, but allows God to bestow his greatness on us, and knows that only in service and self-surrender then we truly find ourselves. describes the persecution of the Church in Mexico, the last priest in the huge province of Tabasco, who's being hunted down like a dog. He's a hero and an anti-hero, a man full of flaws and human weaknesses, but in the end, the shot is a martyr. The amazing thing about the book is that Graham Greene never tells us the priest's name. He doesn't give his priest names because their individuality is overshadowed by the reality of Christ's priesthood, which makes of them a new creation, an instrument of Christ's loving presence among his people. As priests, we are vessels of clay, but the treasure that we bear is the same. It's the presence of the Good Shepherd who heals, who teaches, and who feeds his flock. At the Last Supper, Jesus is praying for his priests. He's praying that they be holy priests, even while they're fighting over the first places at table. Today, this entire congregation is here, AKolla, to pray that you will be a holy priest. That doesn't mean that you'll have an easy life or a successful life or an interesting life, but that you will be a shepherd and a spiritual father to the people, a man of God, because you've climbed that mountain and you'll be able to say, we proclaim to you what we ourselves have actually seen and heard. A couple of months ago, I was giving a retreat to the Portuguese bishop in Fatima. And there was a young priest there who had just been named Auxiliary Bishop of Lisbon. And he came to me during the retreat and he said, Cardinal, please give me a decalogue of how to be a good bishop. I said, listen, I'm not Moses. But I said, I'll try to come up with something. And that night I thought and I prayed and I wrote down some do's and don'ts that I suggested to him. But today I want to play Moses again and propose a decalogue, some do's and don'ts for our new priest. I hope that they will be of some help. First of all, remember that one man sows and another reaps. Ministry is always a team effort, and Christ is always the captain and the quarterback. Tole ad lege, words directed to a great African saint, Augustine. Take and read. Read the Gospels. Pattern your life on what you find there, and then share that by your actions. And even sometimes by your words. Don't be a lover of money. The only real estate Judas got for the 30 pieces of silver was the blood of the field of blood. The Eucharist is the reason for your vocation. Make it the center of your life. Spend time with the Eucharistic Lord. Adoration is placing your head on the Sacred Heart, like John at the Last Supper. Remember the job description that Jesus gives his priests at the Last Supper. Wanted, friends and foot washers. Be a shepherd and a father, not a hireling and a manager. Love your people, be kind and compassionate to them. Make Jesus' priorities your priorities. The care for the sick, mercy, the lost sheep, the widows and orphans, like Padre Pio Solanas Casey in St. Leopold. When you need help, ask for it. Learn to learn from criticism. Friendly and unfriendly. Pay attention to the adverbs in scriptures. St. Paul, in the reading that you chose today, tells us to prophesize, to serve, to teach, to give, to lead, to show mercy. But the scriptures also tell us how we are to do these things with the adverbs. Generously, diligently, cheerfully, humbly, steadfastly, boldly, faithfully. The truth is that the how is just as important as the what. In our refrigerator door in the O'Malley home, there's a great sign that says, "Thou shalt not whine." Be a Barnabas, a son of encouragement, not a complainer. Be convinced that prayer in the life of a priest is as essential as water and air to sustain your life and your ministry. Make sure that thank you and I'm sorry are part of your active vocabulary. And finally, Brother AKolla, we commend you to the care and protection of Mary, the mother of the Divine Shepherd. May she make you a holy priest, a shepherd after her son's own heart. Remember, the smell of the sheep is the Capuchin fragrance. Amen.
Sacrament of reconciliation for the glory of God and the sanctification of the Christian people. You resolve to implore with us God's mercy upon the people entrusted to your care by observing the command to pray without ceasing. You resolve to be united more closely every day to Christ the High Priest, who offered himself for us to the fathers of your sacrifice, and with him to consecrate yourself to God for the salvation of all. You promise respect and obedience to the diocesan bishop and to your legitimate superior. May God, who has begun the good work in you, lead it to fulfillment. My dear people, let us pray that God, your powerful Father, will pour out abundantly the gifts of heaven on this his servant, whom he has chosen for the office of priest.
Let us kneel.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Keep us.
noble spirit and the power of priestly grace, that this man, whom in the sight of your mercy we offer to be consecrated, may be surrounded by your rich and unfailing gifts, through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Let us stand.
Draw near, O Lord, Holy Father, almighty and eternal God, author of all human dignity. It is you who apportion all graces. Through you everything progresses. Through you all things are made to stand firm. To form a priestly people, you appoint ministers of Christ, your Son, by the power of the Holy Spirit, arranging them in different orders. Already in the earlier covenant, offices arose, established through mystical rites. When you set Moses and Aaron over the people to govern and sanctify them, you chose men next in rank and dignity to accompany them and assist them in their task. So too in the desert, you implanted the spirit of Moses in the hearts of 70 wise men, and with their help you ruled your people with greater ease. So also upon the sons of Aaron, you poured an abundant share of their father's plenty, that the number of the priests prescribed by the law might be sufficient for the sacrifices of the tabernacle, which were a shadow of the good things to come. But in these last days, Holy Father, you sent your Son into the world, Jesus, who is apostle and high priest of our confession. Through the Holy Spirit, he offered himself to you as a spotless victim, and he made his apostles consecrated and the truth shares in his mission. You provided them also with companions to proclaim and carry out the work of salvation throughout the whole world. And now we beseech you, Lord, in our weakness, to grant us this helper that we need to exercise the priesthood that comes from the apostles. Grant, we pray, Almighty Father, to this your servant the dignity of the priesthood. Renew deep within him the spirit of holiness. May he henceforth possess this office which comes from you, O God, and is next in rank to the office of bishop. And by the example of his manner of life, may he instill right conduct. May he be a worthy co-worker with our order, so that by his preaching and through the grace of the Holy Spirit, the words of the gospel may bear fruit in human hearts and reach even to the ends of the earth. Together with us, may he be a faithful steward of your mysteries, so that your people may be renewed in the waters of rebirth and nourished from your altar, so that sinners may be reconciled and the sick raised up. May he be joined with us, Lord, in imploring your mercy for the people entrusted to his care and for all the world. And so may the full number of the nations, gathered together in Christ, be transformed into your one people and made perfect in your kingdom through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Sacrifice to God. Receive the oblation of the holy people to be offered to God, and understand what you do, imitate what you celebrate, and conform your life to the mystery of the Lord's cross.
Thank you.
sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
Therefore, Lord, we pray, graciously accept this oblation of our service, that of your whole family, which we make to you also for this your servant, whom you have been pleased to raise to the order of priesthood. And in your mercy, keep safe your gifts in him, so that what he has received by divine commission, he may fulfill by divine assistance. Be pleased, O God, we pray, to bless, acknowledge, and approve this offering in every respect. Make it spiritual and acceptable so that it may become for us the body and blood of your most beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. On the night before he was to suffer, he took bread in his holy and venerable hands, and with eyes raised to heaven, to you, O God, his almighty Father, giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it. For this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took this precious chalice in his holy and venerable hands, and once more giving you thanks, he said the blessing and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. The sacrifice of Abraham, our father, in faith, and the offering of your high priest, Melchizedek, a holy sacrifice, a spotless victim. In humble prayer, we ask you, Almighty God, command that these gifts be borne by the hands of your holy angel to your altar on high, in the sight of your divine majesty, so that all of us who through this participation at the altar receive the most holy body and blood of your Son may be filled with every grace and heavenly blessing.
Remember also, Lord, your servants who have gone before us with the silent faith and rest in the sleep of peace. Grant them, O Lord, we pray, and all who sleep in Christ, place of refreshment, light, and peace.
To us also, your servants, who though sinners, hope in your abundant mercies, fellowship with your holy apostles and martyrs, with John the Baptist, Stephen, Matthias, Barnabas, Ignatius, Alexander, Marcellinus, Peter, Felicity, Perpetua, Agatha, Lucy, Agnes, Cecilia, Anastasia, and all your saints. Amid us, we beseech you into their company, not weighing our merits, but granting us your pardon through Christ our Lord.
Through whom you continue to make all these good things, O Lord, you sanctify them, fill them with life, bless them, and bestow them upon us. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Thank you.
Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word and my soul shall be healed.
Thank you.
First of all, thank you, Cardinal Sean, Brother Sean, for being with us. I really don't know how you make time for us always, because you have so many duties in Boston and with the Holy Father in Rome, so thank you for making time for us. And thank you for saying what you did about the Catholicity of our province, about the fact that our province, the little St. Augustine province, really has this reach to the ends of the earth and to all cultures and all people. I'm so proud of our province. And Sean, you're one of the chief architects of what happened in our province. Without your ministry, we wouldn't be where we are. And another aspect of the Catholicity of our province is Papua New Guinea. Bishop Don being with us today is another great privilege. Papua New Guinea really is the ends of the earth, and we're there. We're grateful for that. I know that some members of AKolla's family weren't able to come from Cameroon, but there are family members here. But the blood relatives stand for us, and we can see you here. Those who are his uncle and his cousins, please stand. I had to say blood relatives because we're all brothers and sisters. And AKolla, thank you. Wonderful fellowship and liturgy. And when I come back to Pittsburgh, they always say to me, either place, they say, what about that Holy Spirit church? What about that thing? You know what I tell them? All I say is they have a choir. Let's see. sing the ultimate together.
Shepherd, to provide the living bread and word of life to the faithful, that they the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen. The Mass has ended. Go in peace.
Thanks be to God.